Richard. For those who don't know me, Richard just said that my name is Robert Simpkins, a professor at DePaul. This is my first year on the campus, and when I was hired to come to the campus about this time last year and realized that the mascot here was the pirate, the Portable Pirates, I immediately thought of my friend Russ and how great it would be if I could get him to come and talk about his research. Professor Russell Skowronek is somebody I've known for about 10 years. And this goes back to when we both lived in San Jose. And at the time, I was adjunct faculty at San Jose State, working on my PhD. Russ was a professor of anthropology at Santa Clara University. And if you're not familiar with Santa Clara University, certainly one of the oldest historic sites in the state, and also a campus that is one big archaeological site. And Russ wasn't just a professor of anthropology, he was also the campus archaeologist. And as I got to know him and worked with him on a number of projects, got to learn a lot about the archaeology in the region, his interest in colonial period archaeology, but I also learned that he was somebody who had lived in different parts of the country. He had been in the upper Midwest, he'd been in the West, he'd been in the Southeast, now in the South in Texas at the University of Texas. He'd done archaeology in all different time periods. He'd done archaeology on land and archaeology in the water, underwater archaeology, which is like taking something that's already complicated and making it a lot harder. So, I think all these interests, the different kind of experience he had, the interest in the early European colonial period in North America, related to what he's going to talk about today, which is about a specific part of this culture, this period, the archaeology of pirates. And it's also a way of having something that many people are familiar with, but can show how archaeology can bring a new light to it, a new perspective to it. Another thing that I wanted to mention about the work that he does, that I think is especially noteworthy, is that he started a program at the University of Texas Pan American, where he's currently teaching, that's called the Community History and Archaeology Program in Schools. Did I get that right?
Yep.
Okay. Now, this is, has the same abbreviation as our program here, CHAP, because it's CHAPS, it has. But it's a program that deals with archaeology locally, about the community history, about oral history, about understanding the world around us and how it's changing. And it's a great idea that, you know, maybe we'll steal and bring here, if you don't mind, in the years to come. But it's something to think about in addition to just pirates. Think about how we understand the past, what things we find to tell us about the past, and this is an important part of what archaeologists in general do. But we're here to learn about pirates, and so I think I want to turn it over then to Russ to talk about the stories he's brought for us. I've heard him talk years in the past, but he says he's got some new things, and I'm excited to hear these, and I hope that you enjoy as well. Professor Russ.
Thank you, Bob, and I want to thank all of you. With a publicist like Bob, the sky's the limits for me. And I have to say to you guys something. I've been over here working the audience already, right? And I go, it's a Friday night. Get a life, okay? No, I'm really happy to have such a wonderful turnout this evening to be able to talk to you about something I'm fairly passionate about, pirates. In fact, I'm very passionate about it. And I'm going to try to share with you, as Bob said, not only archaeological insights into pirates, but basically anthropological ones, historical ones, that will help you, I hope, understand what piracy is about and how piracy comes about. What's very interesting is you can go to Barnes & Noble or wherever bookstore, and there is a cottage industry of stories about pirates, right? But the problem is, it's the same story being told time after time after time. And they all date back to a publication from 1721. And it has been copied since then. The original one, they think, might have been written by none other than Daniel Defoe. But the same stories are told repeatedly. And it's, you know, it's always the stories about pirates and how clear it is. And let's start off to wake everyone up with a mighty yo-ho.
Yo-ho!
Thank you. Well, that yo-ho will start us off, and hopefully by the end you're not going to be saying, oh no. The thing we find as we study pirates is how much of the story of pirates are the same stories that's been told time after time after time that have been embellished by others through time. This is the difference between those books, Angus Constant, I wish I had his paycheck, I wish I had Johnny Depp's, but that's a different one. You'll notice he's my doppelganger. He looks just like me. He's from Kentucky originally, believe it or not. And he's done archaeology with my buddies back in his salad years, but at any rate. No, pirates are an interesting thing because we try to do in our research on pirates, and we are continuing our research on pirates, we've tried to get at the real story of pirates. How do you know a pirate when you see one? Well, how do you determine these things? And so that was the investigation that we took off on. And I guess I should probably, you know, in a sense of, see, I'm doing the right thing, there we go. In the sense of being able to full disclosure is, one only undertakes the study of pirates in a university setting once one is tenured, okay? I need to let you be aware of that. Most of you don't know about tenure, it's called the difference between having a job and not having a job. And fortunately, my colleague, Charlie Ewan, my childhood colleague, that we always said they separated us, he's at East Carolina University, home of the pirates, and they put me at Santa Clara University. They wanted to separate us because we'd been hellions when we were kids and we had continued that way. But we reached a point where people were coming and talking to us and they said, you guys are already talking about pirates, what about studying them? And one of the things you start off with is, you know, and again, trust me, it'll get more exciting. When we look at studying pirates, of course, there have been pirates for thousands of years. And in fact, one of the most famous people captured by pirates was none other than Julius Caesar. You guys have heard of Julius Caesar, right? He was captured by pirates, and they held him for ransom for a long period of time. And he said, I promise you, when I get off this place, I'm going to come back, and we're going to kill you. And he did. And that's been the story of pirates ever since. But most of the stuff that we look at with pirates, we can trace back one of the earliest vessels that was sunk, we believe, by pirates to about 3,000 years ago off of Cyprus. And the original archaeological work was done, and how would you know it was sunk by pirates? The exterior of the vessel had been littered with bronze spear points. And clearly, what had been taken off the vessel were the items of value. There were no human remains, there was nothing else, and the vessel was scuttled. It seems to have been a pirate attack. But most of our knowledge of pirates really dates from the last 300 years, from about 1700. So we are using information that we can bring to bear that includes archaeology, which we'll talk about tonight, right? Tangible things of the past. We've got the written word. Right. Newspaper accounts, everything's, oh, there are pirates attacking us. We've got the spoken word, oral history, stories passed down. I have found stories about none other than Blackbeard the pirate. Blackbeard, who died in 1718, 200 years later, no kidding, on the Outer Banks of North Carolina, they interviewed people who said, that guy Edward Teach was an upright man. He stood up for his neighbors, and it was that bum Maynard that came down here and killed him. 200 years later, oral histories are being passed down about pirates. We also can look at observed behavior. You haven't heard much about pirates in the news in the last 10 years, have you? And I don't mean your teens. Pirates are all over the news, and that's how, I'll tell you what, when I was growing up, I never heard about pirates except, you know, in Treasure Island. And the other thing is, of course, the preserved behavior, the archaeology of these things. So I'm going to try to take you on a little of an education today. Like I said, there'll be a quiz later. And we can start off with some words. There's buccaneer, there's privateer, there's pirate, and there's corsair. And if you're any kind of a fan of pirates, you've probably seen those words all used at different times. Well, I think we need to, first of all, have a little bit of language study here and go through this. Buccaneers is a term that is precisely associated with French adventurers and settlers of what will become Haiti, right? The island of Hispaniola. And in the 17th century, they came on the island of Hispaniola. They started to set up camps. There were lots of cattle and pigs and sheep that had gone wild that the Spanish had left there. And these guys would hunt those animals during the day, and they would put them on their boucanier, their barbecue. And then in their spare moments, when a ship was sailing by, they might go out and plunder it. And so they became known as boucaniers and then buccaneers. So sometimes that term is really associated with a finite group of people. We then have got privateers. And I'll be honest with you, privateers are not, in the truest sense of the word, pirates. And I need to make this point. I don't know if you, do anyone recognize who that is a painting of?
Louder.
Yeah, make it louder if you're out there.
Looks like
Shakespeare. Same time period.
Sir Francis Drake?
Yeah, say it louder.
Sir Francis Drake.
Sir Francis Drake. Sir Francis Drake associated with California. Sir Francis Drake associated with the Great Armada, defeat of the Great Armada of 1588. Sir Francis Drake sailed around the globe, capturing various places. We're going to see him in a few places, in a couple other locations as I talk this evening. He sailed around the globe, and he captured things, and he carried it back to Queen Elizabeth I. He sailed, however, not as a pirate. He sailed as a privateer, that is, a private individual who is given what is called a letter of marque. You can sit up here. There are seats. I don't bite. And it's more comfortable. A letter of marque. He was basically an independent contractor working for the government of England. He was a legitimate, if you will, Navy person at a time period when there was no Navy. So privateers are not pirates. They're fighting the enemies of your monarch. In the American Revolution, we have privateers. That's nothing new, okay? So that's another term. Just keep it straight. Pirates, well, geez, there's your pirate. There's Blackbeard the pirate. Blackbeard the pirate is a true pirate. And what is a pirate? A pirate is anyone who will loot anyone else. They have no honor. They're you can say, ecumenical. We'll rob a Spanish ship just as fast as we'll rob an English ship. And anyone can serve with us. We are not tied to any country. Those are true pirates. And they are known as, you know, again, against all flags often. The last one I throw in here, corsairs, those of us who are old enough to remember World War II, or at least aspects of it, will remember it as a great airplane flown by the Marine Corps. But corsairs actually are usually associated with folks that we call the Barbary pirates and such, operating in the Mediterranean Sea. And the term actually comes from the French word courir, to run. And it was because there would be these hit-and-run tactics. You sail out, you attack someone fast, and you sail back into your harbor. So the term corsair is thrown in there sometimes. But as you can see, these are not coterminous in meaning. Now, we look at our images of piracy. Now, most of you guys are too young to recognize Errol Flynn over here. But I can tell you, for those of us brought up in the age of when there was three channels, if you were lucky, on TV, and the only thing to show on TV were the movies that our mothers and fathers watched in the 1930s and 40s, because there was nothing else on, we grew up watching Maureen O'Hara and Errol Flynn and everyone else on there telling us about people waving swords. You may, however, have grown up with some Peter Pan and Captain Hook. You may have, I hope you've all read Treasure Island. These are all important stories that also capture the general public's image about it. And they can really complicate things, but let me say is, I guess you would all agree with me that we would know a pirate if a pirate had a peg leg, an eye patch, a parrot on their shoulder, and a hook. And so all we have to find is that kind of a constellation of artifacts, and man, we're made. Huh, we'll see. Perhaps these other ones, if I'm too old for you with my other ones, will look more familiar. Obviously, these things have been reproduced and reproduced through time. Now, I want to come to this because, well, I promised you Johnny Depp, and I'll get to him. One of the things that to me has been most curious, and part of this research about trying to look at this, is trying to understand how we get these images of pirates. And I've already talked to you about really the roots of them, and in fact, I am a strong believer that it is the book Treasure Island, and believe it or not, Huckleberry Finn and Tom Sawyer that are some of the key sources for views on pirates. But if you perhaps, if any of you have ever made that trek down to Anaheim, you perhaps have been on this thing. In fact, I remember it very fondly and have been on it a million times. You will see this, and what I have is a number of direct quotes from the book Treasure Island. And as you can see, what did the Walt Disney's Imagineers do? They basically followed the storyline. It says, "Behoris was a great excavation, not very recent, for the sides had fallen in and grass had sprouted on the bottom. The cash had been found and rifled. The 700,000 pounds were gone." And then it goes down here, talks about the skeletons lying on the ground. And of course, the last one, "In my best imitation from the movies." Everyone has to sound like they're from Bristol. "He was a seaman," said George Merry, who bolder than the rest had gone up close and was examining the rags of clothing. "Leastways, this was good sea cloth," right? I mean, this is what they were capturing. This is what Walt Disney did in 1967 when that opened. And of course, as we all know the story, in the last 10 years, it was the first time an amusement park ride was turned into a movie. And I'll have to say, if anybody has now become the epitome of pirates, it ain't Errol Flynn anymore. It is now Captain Jack. And we've all come to love Captain Jack. But one thing I want you to take away as we start this discussion is whether it is Captain Jack or Long John Silver in the original book, I will point something out. Do you have a warm, fuzzy place for Jack Sparrow? Do you have a warm, fuzzy place for Long John Silver? The pirate with the heart of gold? Probably. The reality is, if you reread Treasure Island, he would have gladly slit Jim from sternum to, anyway, to waist to get rid of him. These are pirates. These are folks that operate outside the law. That said, everybody wants to be a pirate. And I will ask people here, who ever had a pirate-themed birthday party? Am I it? Well, I don't know, you parents are letting these children down. Yeah, you get one of those, bucko. You will notice my family on the left and my daughter at the pirate house. And she goes, "Well, Dad, what choice do I have?" And I said, "None." Do you recognize him? Even little Barry Obama dressed up like a pirate. And he made it on the cover of the New York Times. So our president was a pirate. You can go to Savannah, Georgia and see the Pirate House. It's an interesting place. We talk about it in the book. I'm not shilling for the book, but I have to say it. We talked about it, and it's very interesting because this place is called that. They're very proud of it there. You can have the best pecan and crusted chicken in the world. And they say, gee, part of Treasure Island was written there. I don't know. I think this guy wrote it everywhere, but whatever. The issue is pirates sell. People like pirates. We have lots of stories about it. And, of course, from my childhood, my parents always said, when can we throw this crap out? Mom, I'm writing a book about it. Anyhow, games, the original action figures on the bottom from my childhood, and those of you big grown-ups, children today, perhaps go to Treasure Island a few miles over the hill here and go to the casino and watch them sink ships back and forth. These all create images of pirates. Paintings from a century ago by Howard Pyle creates these images. But now we need to talk about the reality. The story of pirates are the stories of sometimes killers, certainly they're kidnappers, there are lots of different things. And the story that we hear about tend to be the stories about the ones that aren't very successful, because we all know the most successful people are never caught. But I like to start with this picture here, because this is the jail in Williamsburg, Virginia. In this jail in Williamsburg, Virginia, none other than the surviving members of Blackbeard's crew were brought after Blackbeard was, allegedly, he was killed, but was killed off of Ocracoke, North Carolina. They were brought, they were tried, and they were hanged. And they were hanged all along the road from Williamsburg down to what is today Norfolk in Virginia, as a warning to others. And I will say that is me and my co-author in the stocks there at Williamsburg. The reality about it is pirates knew that they had gone beyond all law. And we have at least documentary records that show that at least 400 pirates had been captured and were executed in that 10-year period. Of course, there were far more, but in that 10-year period. And I show these pictures because the interesting thing about piracy, and I just should talk about it for a moment, is that these folks involved in it were tried by admiralty courts. That is, not by local courts, but by people representing the British Royal Navy and Admiralty. And therefore, when they were hanged below in the area between low water and high water. And what that meant was that once you were dead, they would let the water wash over your body three times, that is basically a day and a half, as the tides rise and fall. And then they would take you down, and they would place you in the middle picture in a series of iron hoops and such. They would cover your body with tar, and then they would hang it up as a warning to sailors, this is what happens to you. And I'll say this for the youngsters to try to be calm, so look away. The one story I always like to tell is about the so-called pirate, who was anything but a pirate, William Kidd, Captain Kidd. Captain Kidd was not a pirate. Captain Kidd was a privateer. He returned from his expedition to the Indian Ocean, fabulously wealthy. The people that had backed him in London said, oh, it's great to have you back, Bill. They took all his money away and they said, you're a pirate. And he says, that's not true. I have my documents. Let me defend myself in court. And they said, we've misplaced them, Bill. The day came to hang him. They were taking him down to Wapping on the Thames to be hanged. And on their way through London, they would stop at every pub and he'd have another drink. And he had another drink. And they hauled him down there and he was drunk as a lord, as they say. And the time came and they put the rope around his neck and around two other guys that had been with him. And they kicked the rope out from under him. And the rope broke and William Kidd fell into the mud of the Thames. Next to him, two of his friends did the short drop. The short drop is known as basically your neck doesn't break, you choke to death. He sobered up fast. They rewove the rope, and this time it held. 200 years later, in 1911, oh, we found the missing documents. William Kidd was innocent. But some very wealthy lords in England remained very wealthy. How do we spot illicit behavior? Bad people. How do we spot it? Oh, well, we look for contraband items. Oh, contraband items. Well, what's that mean? Well, contraband might be, today, are we supposed to have Cuban cigars? No. Are we supposed to have Cuban rum or anything else? No, that's contraband. But if I said to you, in 1960, was it okay to have Cuban cigars and Cuban rum? So part of it, it's hard to spot, right? What is today's contraband might not have been contraband before. It's hard to do. But maybe it's location. Gee, why is all this hidden in this place? You're hiding it, right? You're gonna move it. Is there specialized tools to be a ne'er-do-well? It's hard to say, you know. Maybe a special ship to go fast. Maybe special guns, specialized transportation. Are there special clothing to be a pirate? I have to always have an eye patch. Why not? And how do we catch them? Well, they don't want to say it, but the reality is they want to catch people like they do on television. And most of it is done not through careful detective work. But in the past, if you guys are old enough to remember these shows, how did they solve all the crimes? They had someone help them out. And just as we see that today, that often was the case in the past. Because one problem you run into, how do you tell a pirate? I'm a legitimate sailor. I'm not evil. I haven't done anything wrong. And the same is true for shipwrecks. Ships don't go down and have the name of the ship on the side. If they do at the beginning, it disappears very fast. As Bob said, I've done lots of underwater archaeology, and it is rare to find wood preserved because animals eat them. So it's hard to find things to identify it, but you could say, oh, do gold coins make a pirate ship? Well, we'll look at this. How would you recognize Blackbeard's ship, the Queen Anne's Revenge? Very good question, because back about 15 years ago, they found off of North Carolina the remains of a sailing ship. And they looked at it and they said, oh my, this has to be the Queen Anne's Revenge. And archaeologists went out and looked at it, and they went through it and they built a case. They said, boy, this has to be Blackbeard's ship for this reason and this reason and this reason. And then other archaeologists went and looked at the exact same information and said, well, we could also explain it this way, totally different. And one of the things they looked at initially was they looked at the remains of the vessel, and you know, its location was good, some of the stuff preserved that was good, but they looked at one of these guns. And you can see here on the lower left, one of the guns off the vessel. And can somebody in the front row, I'll wake you up. Can you read those numbers that you see written on there on the left side? Yeah, go ahead, read them out in order.
173
Question mark, right? Just say, we don't know. 173, huh. Let me say something to you. What do you guys, if you first looked at this, might be your first thought, what those numbers represent?
A date.
Wouldn't that be what you would think? If I said to you, Blackbeard scuttled his ship in 1718, what would that do to this? See, all of a sudden you say, wait a minute, that's at least 12 years earlier, right? And then they're looking at it. But you see, the one issue is that you also have to do your research. Remember I said the spoken word, the written word, all this stuff? That doesn't represent a date. It represents the weight of the gun. Because these were sailing ships, you had to balance the guns on each side, and they didn't always weigh the exact same amount. When we first published our book, X Marks the Spot, we had both arguments in there. Now we can say without any doubt, this was Blackbeard's ship. And why? Not because of the guns, but because found in part of the ship between places, believe it or not, were little particles of gold that could be traced to West Africa. And we know that this ship, the one that was alleged to be his ship, had been previously used as a slaving vessel. And they had gone to West Africa, and they had gold that they'd gotten there, and there also were shackles and other things. We could build a case for it being Blackbeard's ship. Another vessel I'll quote you about quickly was known as the Speaker, and this was found in the Indian Ocean. It was the first vessel ever excavated that someone said was a pirate ship, and they were lucky because it was the only wreck found in this one area. Off there, the French archaeologists looked at it, and they got inside, and they said, boy, here it is, it's a pirate ship. And they then wrote it up, and of course, we asked the question, how do you know it's a pirate ship? And on the left, you'll see the breech of one of the guns found on the ship. The breech of that gun is marked with all of the markings of something from France, from the Royal Navy of France. Huh. Why would a Royal Navy of France gun be on a pirate ship? And people are going, that's interesting. Because they keep thinking that pirate ships are different somehow, right? On the right is a hand grenade. And you go, oh, that's interesting. Well, not only pirates use hand grenades, lots of people use hand grenades in the army, grenadiers, and others. Other items were found on board the vessel. Jeez. Navigational tools. Everybody needs navigational tools. They're European. What makes them pirates? Nothing. A sundial to tell what time of the day it is. On the bottom right, glass beads and clay tobacco pipes. All commonly found on archaeological sites in Eastern North America and across Europe in this time period, the 18th century. Well, what about treasure? Oh, well, we found treasure, they said. On the top left are small bronze statues from southern India. Those may look familiar to you, Bob. On the top right is a coin with writing on it in Arabic. In the bottom right is a Spanish piece of eight. And on the left, believe it or not, are gold coins from Venice. And I said, oh, it proves it's a pirate ship because look at all those different coins. All right, there we go again. Anyone that's here that can remember the time period before 1964 in this country will remember that money had a very distinctive ring in your pocket. And I'm talking about half dollars, 25 cent pieces, and dimes. Because before 1964, they were made of silver. And you know what? In the United States, coins minted under Spain were legal tender until 1855. Coinage and money in the past were only valuable because of specie, not because of whose picture was on the front of the coin. So it was very common to pick it up. And I'll say this to you guys, to this day, when I was living up in Michigan, I got Canadian money, and I lived down near Mexico, and I occasionally get pesos. It happens in these places. So again, it's hard to find. What are pirates? Well, they're terrorists because there are folks out there. We have pirates that are river pirates. I remember hearing about Abraham Lincoln and how he was set upon by pirates. Some of you may be old enough to remember Davy Crockett and the river pirates. And of course, these all are part of American history. People being set upon in the Ohio and the Mississippi River to find, to take advantage of settlers or tradesmen, very much pirates. But one famous one is in southern Illinois called Cave and Rock. And these folks would stop vessels, flatboats going down the Ohio, and they would kill the folks for what's on board. Well, my colleagues in Illinois found the wreck of a flatboat. And they all jumped up and down and said, it was sunk by pirates. Well, they excavated it, and of course, silver spoons, axes, all these tools that you'd need to have a new life in the West. And then they realized it wasn't sunk by pirates, it had run on a snag. People wanted it to be sunk by pirates. There was no evidence that it was sunk by pirates. Other things that we look for the effects of pirates as terrorists are what happens to victims. I can tell you St. Augustine was burnt to the ground by Drake, not a pirate. I can tell you that Panama City was burnt to the ground by Henry Morgan, not a pirate, a privateer. In both situations, though, archaeologically, it is a horizon, a way to mark when something happened. And how do you respond to it? St. Augustine, Havana, Puerto Rico, and today, the border wall in South Texas. That's how we respond. These things are not new things, but this is how people respond, right? We put up walls. It gets better. Are these legitimate folks? Well, I've already told you about it, and we'll get past this, but the issue is, how do you tell legitimate businessmen or smugglers? Anyone recognize these pictures? No, you don't. You're young, miss. But I'll tell you what. The left side, okay, who can tell me what movie that is?
Godfather.
The Godfather. And what did he say throughout The Godfather? I'm a legitimate businessman. And who recognizes the people on the right side of the screen? The Kennedy family. Often said to have been bootleggers during Prohibition. You'll notice something. Doesn't matter if you're the godfather of the Kennys, you wear nice black silk suits and you drive a Packard, and you know what? You live in a compound. Compounds guarded by guys with guns. Not necessarily named Vito, but you know what I'm driving at. What makes someone legitimate? And one of the issues that come in is, how do you fly below the radar so you're not caught? Jean Lafitte was said to have been a blacksmith in New Orleans. Jean Lafitte, however, was also known to operate as a smuggler, bringing things into New Orleans off of the narrow islands, which are now rapidly washing away because of oil spills and everything else, but across Barataria Bay. He was involved in smuggling people as well as materials. We know Yul Brynner liked to play him in a movie 40 or 50 years ago, but the reality is that he was a smuggler, and he also claimed himself to be a legitimate businessman. That said, he did leave, and he ended up dying off of what is today Belize, and he is buried down there to this day. So we'll talk more about it. I mentioned to you about pirates as terrorists. First of all, if you're a pirate, no one is safe from attack. You can't appease pirates. Pirates won't be appeased. They want something from you, basically money. We know that in this 30-year period, 1690 to 1720, we have records for at least 3,000 attacks by pirates. And then the piracy stopped. It stopped because there were police. The English suppressed pirates in parts of the world, and later the Americans suppressed piracy in parts of the world. And as a result of suppressing it, we don't think about pirates. As I said to you, if I asked you guys 10 years ago to tell me about pirates, the only thing you would have talked about would have been Treasure Island. So we start back at the beginning. Can we recognize pirates? Are there personal items that we would find? I'm putting you to sleep, but stay with me. This is really good. First of all, these are, if we're talking about sailors from 300 years ago, there are a couple things to keep in mind. At that time period, there was no such thing as a uniform worn in a navy anywhere in the world. I ask a question. Has anyone here been in the service? Anyone been in the Army or Navy? You've been in service. That's right, you were in service there. Richard, let me ask you. There were two types of uniforms. There was your dress uniform, and there were your fatigues. The fatigues you wore every day. And I would hazard to guess that when you got out of the service, your dress uniform went in the closet, and it's still there. And your fatigues you took, and you started to wear them, and you would cut the grass in them. And then later, as you wore out the elbows, you cut the sleeves off. And then you had holes in the knees, and they became short pants. And then after that, they became the rag you washed the car with, and then you threw them away. That's a working uniform. Navy people have the same stuff. Whenever we think about pirates, they're not wearing their fancy clothes on the ships. That's stored below. They have their work uniforms. And you know what? A pirate's work uniforms looks like a sailor's work uniforms looks like that. Hard to see. And what's good about that? If you can make a landing, it's easy to blend into the general populace. All right? That's why I'm using those analogies from movies and TVs. And it's hard to catch these people unless you catch them in the act. And I show these pictures here to show you something. You notice this gent on the top right? He's got a peg leg. Oh, he's got a peg leg. And remember, Long John Silver had a peg leg. And let me ask you a question. What was Long John Silver's job on the ship when they were going out this by oil?
He was a cook.
He was a cook. And the reason he was a cook was because in the 18th century, in battle, if you had a limb carried away, they would keep you in the Navy, but the only thing you could really handle was being a cook. And there's a guy with a peg leg serving as a cook. Does that make him a pirate?
No.
All right. You're all busted. No one's ever done this, have you? I've never downloaded anything. All right, you're all laughing, right? Oh, but it's innocent. Take that to the guys who own the copyrights, right? Hard to catch them. And these great newspaper articles from the San Jose Mercury News were always talking about them. Hard to catch them unless they catch you in the act, and God knows there are a few college students that their parents won't be taking home anytime soon. But what about modern pirates? Let's talk about that. Some of you might remember the Achille Laurel, taken over by the Palestine Liberation Front. Were those pirates? Well, they certainly didn't have a country then, maybe. You'll remember the USS Cole back in 2000, attacked by Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda's not a state. Does that make them pirates because it took place at sea? In the southern Philippines, Abu Sayyaf are referred to as pirates. Today, the Straits of Malacca and the South China Sea and Somalia are filled with pirates that we've been rearing about. And they're hard to catch unless in the act. But I want to point it out that it's very real. Well, look at this statistic. One vessel was captured in 2009 and was held for nearly 3 years. They released 22 people after 1,000 days. The cover of the New York Times talks about a man and a woman captured and then taken to a place in Somalia and held for over a year. And they were held for ransom. No different than in the past. And today we look at where lots of the piracy is taking place, and of course it's taking place off of Africa. And I like to show you just sort of these numbers of attacks, these things that are taking place. And you can see these things with the dates. Look at all these attacks that have took place. How many of those did we hear about? You only heard about maybe the Maersk Alabama, the one American vessel that was taken. But this is a reality. There were 5,000 reported pirate attacks in that 20-year period. 5,000. Remember, we had 3,000 in a 30-year period. It's unbelievable. And you look at this, the number of people that are hurt and killed, and what weapons are they using? Guns, knives, and other weapons that are very commonly found around the world. AK-47s, pistols, anything else like that. And you know what? Every week, you can check the weekly piracy reports. And you can see some of the numbers have started to go down recently. You can see the numbers have gone down, and the reason is because there's more policing. And I'm going to get to why this is all happening here, but I want to get you to this here. Here's your report for this week. I downloaded this Monday when I was getting ready to come see you. And you can see, as of this week, there have been 76 attacks, 4 hijackings, and as you can see, 4 vessels are still held with 77 hostages on board. Why are there so many attacks in these locations? The reason there are so many attacks in these locations is that prior to 1992, there were two superpowers in the world. Right? United States and who? Soviet Union. And they had client states, is the term, right? You're either your friends or you're not our friends. And the client states we had, we gave them money and guns. And those of you who will remember this is in 1992, the Soviet Union collapsed, and we talked about the peace dividend. And what happened? We closed our Navy bases, we closed everything else, and we stopped giving money to people. And all of a sudden, different parts of the world, states collapsed. Somalia collapses, other places collapse. There's no money. And when you reach a stage, to quote the old song, where you ain't got nothing left to lose, you become a pirate. Because when you become a pirate, you remember what I said happens to pirates 300 years ago? Hang them. And that takes me to this stage. What you are looking at here are some pictures of pirates, and I want you to notice something rather interesting is lined up on the side, they're not having a party, Molotov cocktails. Think about that as things that are easy to hide. You will notice a small boat, and guys are armed with rocket-propelled grenades right out of any of these war fronts, AK-47s, knives, and other items. The container ships only have fire hoses, and you might say, why? I'll explain why. You own the container ship. Do you want to pay to have a policeman on board that container ship if you don't run into a pirate? Because what's the bottom line? Money. And so the idea is to keep them away with fire hoses. But once they get on board, they say, take anything you want. The problem is when they take hostages, when they take the ship. And we know that those things happen. I want you to look at this picture, and you should be stunned. Because this picture shows the side of a container ship, and those are the pirate ships of today. The pirate ships are small little fishing boats, fast runabouts. They can run fast out from the shore, and they can get in close to shore when they're running away. And guess what? Navy ships can't chase them, because they'll run on the rocks. But I want you to see the one thing that tells me it's a pirate ship. How do you get up out of a boat onto the side of a vessel like that? See what's going up there? That's their ladder. It's their ladder. Now I'm going to go to this next slide, and I don't think I'll show it tonight, Bob, but we may crank it up later. But I want to show you first this picture. Does that painting look familiar? I showed you before by Howard Pyle. That's the pirate ship. The little one. That's the vessel they're attacking. Why? Get in, get out. So here's my next picture, and I'll talk about it. When pirates are caught today, lucky ones are taken to places like Kenya. They are tried and they're put in jail. They're not necessarily executed. Those are the lucky ones. If you paid attention to the Maersk Alabama, the captain was held for days. He made friends with his captors. We often hear about that for survival. They wouldn't give him up. They wouldn't give him up. And the Navy SEALs took care of them. One of them was a 17-year-old boy. It's tragic, but he was doing this because it was his way to make money. These are the lucky ones. This is some film footage of a pirate ship caught by Russians. The Russian Navy is on board this vessel. There is a guy lying on the deck, shot in the leg, bleeding out on the deck. And the Russians are speaking to them in a combination of Russian and English. And they're saying, what are you? We're fishermen, we're fishermen. And they're filming the whole thing. And they say, fishermen, where are your nets? Fishermen, where are your hooks and lines? Fishermen, why do you have this 30-foot ladder? And then they start pulling out sawed-off AK-47s, pulling out knives, pulling out pistols. And the Russians go through, they document this thing. It's about a 6-minute film. And at the end, it's interesting because they're all sitting with their hands up, and then they take those plastic handcuffs, they handcuff it. And it's interesting, the film stops for a second, and then it's back on the bridge of the Russian destroyer. And you can see in the distance this thing bobbing in the water, and the next moment, it explodes. The Russian Navy was exercising the right of all countries to be judge, jury, and executioner. They sent them to the bottom of the ocean.
Я. У меня останется, чё?
Передай нужную помощь, здесь раненый, нужен доктор.
Сколько их?
Один.
Сказали,
Абордажное устройство.
Еще одна, смотри. Николай.
Сейчас, секундочку.
Нулевой, я 21-й.
Абордажное устройство номер 2.
Somalian.
Pistol. I know.
TT.
I know this is pistol.
Ну давай, еще оружие нашли, автоматы, боеприпасы.
What the fuck is that? What the fuck is that?
Do we have any grenades?
Have grenades?
Это не советского производства.
You see, this is our store. This is our fishing store, our fishing also.
Why do you lie to me? This is not a fishing boat.
This is fishing
boat. Еще второй тут тоже. Иван, выходи на связь, говори 2 ТТ. И сколько автоматов от МС?
Считай.
Раз, два, четыре, пять, шесть, семь.
Семь автоматов.
Да, 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 да,
да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да,
да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да, да,
Связь.
По одному?
Пакистанцев по одному.
Да.
Пакистанцев.
Вот еще права.
Пакистан. Пакистан. Стандарт. Стандарт.
Давай, давай, давай. Сейчас зашибут трапу. Вот сюда прям вложи.
Помоги ему длинно выпасть, выпиши трап.
Стремный! Давай, шлак! Не-не-не, ничего не надо. Не рани!
Да, еще, блядь.
разом.
А ну что ты там, на гонит? Так и будет гонить? Там же топливо. Нет, ну понятно, что он плавает. Я пополам разорвал.
Помрос. Ну короче, все, блядь. Она уже не отремонтировалась.
Я думаю, что уже затонет. Ну, а пошла. Если бы еще топлива не было, она бы взорвалась.
Бензинчик, хорошо. Да.
Еще кусок отлетел и горит на ладе, да?
It's a hard world. And why did it happen? Because of inequalities. Because these people were hungry. But the Russians did what they felt they needed to do. Next to me, and I'm coming close to the end here, I live on the border of Mexico, as you heard, along the Rio Grande. This man and this woman were playing on a reservoir down there. And all of a sudden, jet skis came out, and they shot him. And the wife is out there, and she gets away, and they carry his body back into Mexico. They never found his body, and the question is, were they pirates? And as you see here, not according to the definition of the United Nations. On the high seas, against the ship or aircraft, persons or property, in a place outside the jurisdiction of any state. The river of the Rio Grande is not outside the jurisdiction of either Mexico or the United States. So in the truest sense, not pirates. But in the truest sense, they're just as dead. Finally, I have a quiz on California. This is a new thing. Everyone said to me, well, what about California's pirates? And I said, California's pirates? You don't mean Sir Francis Drake. What's there to be pirates about in the, you know, 1600s, 1500s? And they said, oh, no, you mean Bouchard and his raids on California. So here's a painting of Hippolyte Bouchard, and I'm going to ask you at the end, hero or pirate? Background. At the 200 years ago, Spain, the country of Spain, is invaded by Napoleon. The crown is pushed out, and Napoleon puts his brother on the throne of Spain. While Napoleon is occupying Spain, the Americas, Spanish America, says, you know what? We don't want to be part of you. And of course, we hear in California a lot about Mexico, right? Father Hidalgo, 1810. But also in 1810, Colombia declares its independence. Argentina declares its independence. And not unlike the United States, wars rage for the next decade or more, and folks are, until they get freedom from Spain. So who's Hippolyte Bouchard? He was born in France, a sailor in the French Navy during the Napoleonic Wars. He gets to Buenos Aires in 1809, and he leaves the Navy for a few years. And he serves with the famous San Martin of fame in South America, and he defeats the Spanish army. And then in 1815, they said, you need to go back to sea, and we're going to put you in charge of our ship, the Argentine. And Captain Hippolito Bouchard is told, go out and make war on Spain, our enemy. And he sails to the Philippines, Guam and the Marianas, Central America, and California. And that was their flag, and it's a postage stamp. And he arrives here and he attacks the Presidio of Monterey. He shoots at the Presidio of Monterey, like we've talked about, and he burns the town, just as other people have burned the town after they looted it. And he raises the flag and says, California is part of Argentina. I don't think people remember that very much. They might frown on it today, I don't know. He then goes south and he attacks Santa Barbara and up near the airport by Santa Barbara. And you can today go to the Santa Barbara courthouse and see this painting, and what does it say? The pirate Bouchard pillaging Rancho Refugio. They're calling him the pirate. Let me ask you a question. For Spain, was he a pirate?
No.
For Spain?
Spain.
For Spain, he was a pirate because he was making war on his own people. The people in California at that time were drastically loyal to Spain. In Texas, they were loyal to Spain at that time. 25 years later, they weren't loyal to Mexico, but by God, they were loyal to Spain. He was seen as a pirate by the Spanish. But I think you see what the answer is. He continues down the coast. He goes to San Juan by Capistrano. You can see he sets fire to the king's storehouse. And my favorite part is, and they kind of got drunk. But they had a great time doing it. The last part is this one. There's the answer. He's not a pirate. Why? And I'll tell you why. Because the victors write the histories. If Argentina had fallen back under the crown, they would have hanged him as a pirate. But they had declared their independence, just as the United States did, and they sent him out with a letter mark. That's his letter mark. But I'm going to ask you a question, and this is why. So, American Civil War, we're in the sesquicentennial now, guys. You remember the American Civil War, don't you? So, were the Confederate States traitorous scum? They were. They were. But if you hear the Southerners speak about it, we were the true blue Americans of our time period. The Bonnie Blue flag out there against those rascal Yankees. When we talk about the end of the American Civil War, we talk about the issues of with malice toward none, with charity for all. But there were many people that wanted to hang Robert E. Lee, that wanted to hang the leaders of the Confederacy because they were traitors. They didn't do it, but you could take it to the logical step. You know, I end on these last few images. Modern images can create false expectations. On the left were the books my father used to read on his interminable airplane trips to the South Pacific. They carried a guy from World War II into the interesting, you know, romance of the time period. And some of us older folks read Jimmy Buffett and think about being pirates to this day. Some people have pirates as mascots. Whether it's baseball teams, football, yeah, you betcha. Or you remember the Pirate Bowl, played between Tampa Bay and Oakland. You can send your children to the Stanford Pirate Camp. You can, oh God help you if you do this, because I have to. On September 19th is National Talk Like a Pirate Day. You've never been so tired by going, arr. I get emails by the boatload from all my friends writing, arr. And it's like, oh God, I'm so tired. But pirates are there. This is what we talk to our children. We find them to be fun. We find them to be everything else. And I'm not saying that we can't love them. I like Johnny Depp. But you've seen the real story of pirates. What do we expect to find? And this is the hard part. Do pirates wear special clothing?
No.
Do they have special technology or different ships than others, per se?
No.
Did they eat different foods? I haven't talked about foods, but bottom line is, in those days there were no refrigerators, no ice cream on ships. No. And their success lay in their ability to blend in. Remember, the most successful ne'er-do-well is the ones that are never caught. And, you know, when we started this story, and I was trying to give you my point behind this, we took that as our challenge. And we went to all our colleagues and we said, if you didn't have documents that said this is a pirate ship, how would you know? And I've got news for you. People look distinctly uncomfortable. And the one thing that we're doing is, because of this original work, don't wait for the movie. Wait for Johnny Depp. But the reality is we've continued to work. We're going to be putting out another book this coming year, and I want to tell you what this work is leading us toward. There aren't special uniforms. There aren't special items. But we are starting to point out certain things. I'll put an example. Many pirate ships had originally been built as slave vessels to bring slaves from Africa. Who here knows why that would have been the choice? Anyone? Any suggestions? Miss, ma'am.
So that they could control their hostages?
That's one possibility. I like that.
Large
cargo holds to bring things.
Probably because slavery became illegal, and therefore those vessels were not useful anymore, so they were cheap.
You guys are really good, but let me give you another thing, and this is really gross, but bear with me. Oftentimes they say that slaves are what kinds of cargoes? Starts with a P. Thank you. Perishable cargoes. And that's a horrible term, but you understand what I'm driving at. And remember, every enslaved person that dies is less profit margin. Economics. Slave vessels are built to be fast. Slave vessels are built to be able to sail up those shallow rivers in West Africa to load the human cargoes on board. They have a shallow draft. When you're being chased by somebody that wants to catch you, what are they going to do to you when they catch you?
Damn.
You want a fast boat. And NASCAR wanted a fast car to pull liquor. And so we're starting to look at these trends. What are we finding? What do these vessels look like? But some of the most obvious things are the things that are not there. And I hope I didn't ruin it for the kids. We all want to be pirates. You saw it. Little Barry Obama and a little Russ Skoranek. But the reality is, when we try to study illicit behavior archaeologically, it really is based on where you find things, how they're dated. Can we understand, is this really a sign of it? And it's just like having a still during Prohibition. You can all make liquor legally during Prohibition. You just can't sell it. And where do we still have stills? In the backwoods. And just like until recently, California, you couldn't grow other crops. But, you know, now we can. I won't go any further because I'm not going to get arrested. On that note, I will now take comments, questions, and scathing rebuttals. And I thank you for your time on a Friday night. So questions? I'm ready. Get me. Oh, come on. Well, if you're not going to say anything, be careful. I'm a professor. I can do this all night.
Come and hear us.
Women pirates.
Well, there are the two famous ones that we know about from the records, Anne Bonny and Mary Read, the two that were there. What's very interesting in these stories is that it was actually... You know, it's hard to know about how many women pirates, but women often were known to serve in military forces. We know that, and oftentimes it was to follow spouses. And while it was not uncommon for women to follow the camp and be washerwomen and sewing clothing and everything else, when they shipped out overseas, that wasn't an option. And so I know of at least a few, one of them, the husband was in the Royal Marines, shipped out to India. She enlisted in the Marines. and she went to India and served there, came back later and opened a pub in London. And we know that in the American Revolution, women served, not Molly Pitcher, but in uniform, and then later came back. Women often did serve in those capacities, and we know that. The fact is often said about Mary Read and Anne Bonny was that they served, they were together, they were with Calico Jack, and apparently I'm trying to think which one it was, screamed at him when he was condemned to die, "If you'd fought more like a man, you wouldn't die like a dog." Boy, now that's a way to go, guys. So your wife telling you that. So, but women did play a role in there, and you got to keep in mind again, hard enough for men. There weren't many options for women at the lower end of the scale, so we do know that. I don't have any more specific than that, but one thing's for sure, it's not easy to, at one level, hide things, but I will also say, you know, people say, how could they have done that? Well, easily, because when people go to the bathroom, the front of the vessel is called the head. And the reason it's called the head is because that's known the heads of the ship, and when you go to the bathroom. People sit down out there, you can't see anything, because you get splashed with water. You don't have any problems like that. And most of these women are found out when they get wounded in battle. It's like, huh, something's wrong here. So, sorry, I mean, not everything, but...